Lesson 13, Ambush, Part 1, Chapter 3. Computations of data for mortar and howitzer positions. Now we can compute firing data for our mortar positions. Let's copy the horizontal distances and height differences between point P1 and marks M1, M5 into one set. Length wind and side wind are of the same value because we fire along the same axis line. These values too are copied. Afterward, we copy all relevant data from the ballistic table. We will use 120 mm Soviet mortar of 1943 model. Proceeding from the precept of using minimal possible charge, we should use the third charge, but it would be at the limit of its range for M1. Therefore, we would use fourth charge, which has the ranges from 1.5 km to 3,960 m. It covers our distances with good margins. Table data is given for distances with 100 meters steps. The most important column is quadrant settings. After it goes correction for side wind of 10 meters per second force. Correction is in mils. The following column is the correction for length wind of 10 meters per second force. This correction is in meters of distance. The following column is correction for change in air pressure of 10 millimeters. Correction is in meters of distance. The following column is the correction for 10 degrees change in temperature in meters of distance. The last column is correction for 10 degrees change in powder charge temperature in meters of distance. The charge temperature is usually taken as equal to the air temperature. Ballistic tables contain some other useful information, but we have taken only the most relevant columns. To simplify the interpolation computations, we need to find interpolation factor. Now we compute data for position P1 against M1. The interpolation factor is found in cell K551. The lower margin is subtracted from the distance we have, and this difference is divided by the difference of high and low margins, or to say it simply, by 100 meters. The quadrant setting is found in cell B551. The result is rounded. It is rounding function. The side wind correction is found in cell C551. The table data is given for 10 meters per second side wind. We have 4.5 meters per second wind. Therefore, we need to divide this value by 10 and multiply by interpolated value for our distance. In this case, we don't even need to interpolate because both margins have equal values of 18. Therefore, we simply divide 4.5 by 10 and multiply by 18, rounding the number, and in the result have 8 mils of side correction. The positive side correction means that we need to turn crosshair 8 mils clockwise to compensate for the wind force pushing projectile to the left. The length wind correction is found in cell D551. The lengthwise wind component is divided by 10 and multiplied by the interpolated value. So we have 32 meters. To have uniform and simple for perception results, I have added the negative sign beforehand to the expression. So we have positive result. It means that we should add this value to the computed distance to compensate for lengthwise wind component, which has opposite vector to our projectile direction. The correction for change in air pressure is found in cell E551. The deviations from normal pressure is given in cell J534. We need to divide it by 10 and to multiply this result by interpolated value for this factor. Here again, we don't even need to interpolate because both margins have equal values. So we have minus 6, which means that we should decrease distance by this value. The correction for air temperature is found in cell F551. The deviation of temperature from normal is in cell I534. This value is divided by 10 and multiplied by interpolated value. Here too, we need to place negative sign in the expression to have consistent final result. Air temperature is higher than normal, therefore the distance needs to be decreased. In the same way, the correction for charged temperature is found in cell G551. In cell H551, we add all distance corrections together and have minus 1 meter, which in essence means that there should be any distance corrections. But for the purpose of presentation, we will complete full procedure. In cell H553, we add the found distance correction with the real distance and round the result. The new interpolation factor is found for corrected distance. Cell K553. The new quadrant setting value is computed in cell B554. The value remains the same because corrections are too small to affect quadrant setting. Now we need to adjust for height difference between position and target. Here we need to do double interpolation. The table values are given with steps of 200 meters for distances and 50 meters for heights. First, we interpolate for our height difference, but for the distance 2800, cell B561. In cell C561, we do the same interpolation for the distance 3000. In cell D561, we interpolate between margins of 2800 and 3000. We operate by the values found in cells B561, C561. Our distance in cell B534 and marginal distance values. So we have to reduce our quadrant setting by 23 mils to compensate for target being lower than position. The final results are shown in cells F560 and H560. As the data is computed in the same way, three positions gains 5 points each. And as you can see, these computations are essentially the same. And these are the final results for quadrant inside adjustment against M2 target, against M3 target, against M4 target, and against M5 target. Now we need to compute data for our howitzer position P14. And this is the same computation for P2 and P3 mortar positions against 5 targets each. And it is our howitzer. We will use two types of shells: the non-spinning armor-piercing shells with shaped charges, and the fragmentation shells. We need to deal with enemy tanks, and this howitzer is the most potent gun in our inventory. Using artillery for short ranges against visible targets is more simple and requires less computation, but in the same time, if you deal with moving targets, it requires well-trained crew and good practice. The most important question here is to how much ahead of the moving target you need to aim. For this, you need to know target speed. It could be evaluated approximately, or you can measure some stretch of the road and measure time of the column's leading vehicle passing this distance. It should be done on immediate approach of the column to the ambush site and the information relayed to the gun. The question about how to relay the information could be the most difficult one. If you use radio, you could spoil the whole operation by alerting the enemy. You need to operate under radio silence. All comments and other information is to be transferred by means of visual signals. You could use radios only when battle begins, and even this is not advisable. Although the ambushed enemy is no longer able to avert their fate, there are some other enemy forces nearby that could monitor all radio signals and trace their sources. Therefore, the radio silence is the absolute rule that should be observed in all situations when you are fighting against technologically advanced enemy. In most cases, you will need to evaluate enemy's speed without precise measurements. It is particularly the case when battle began and the enemy vehicles move in unexpected directions and with changing speed. When the first shots were fired, the most probable reaction of the enemy vehicles would be to increase their speed and try to go out of the ambush site. Therefore, all previous computations of the enemy's speed would become useless. It is why the artillery crew dealing with moving targets needs to be well trained and to be able to respond to the typical enemy actions. Here, the task is simplified by the fact that enemy could move only along the road. Therefore, you can beforehand model your response to this action, to his actions. The fact that your position is the enfilading one greatly helps. The lateral shifts of the targets are very small, and consequently the crosshair needs to be set ahead by much less value. You need to analyze and rehearse your response for the eventuality of the enemy tanks breaking forward and moving further along the road. The road changes the direction, and you would have more difficulties. More difficulties in striking moving target. In the worst case, when tanks are speeding ahead and moving with 60 kilometers per hour speed on the road, you will have 1.5 minutes to fire at them. After it, they would either move out of your field of view or stop opposite of your location and fire at you. This scenario would be possible only in the case of employing untrained gun crew that was not able to hit even one tank. We need to deal with only three tanks. Other less armored targets most probably would be annihilated by other weapons. But the main stake here is on immobilizing the column and blocking its ability to move forward. We assume the cruising speed of the column to be 40 kilometers per hour. It is 11 meters per second. The approximate length of the tank is 6 meters. In a battle, you need to evaluate distances in targets' lengths when shooting at moving targets. We are shooting at a visible target, therefore we don't need to compute horizontal angle, only quadrant setting. At short distances, trajectories are flat, and differences in quadrant settings are not great. The first shot is to be done at the head of the column. It is M1 point. The distance is 1337 meters. Quadrant setting is 13. It is computed in the usual way of interpolating table data. For short distances, you don't even need to do precise computations, but to interpolate approximately. The time of shell's flight is 2.4 seconds. And again, it is rounding function. The shift of the target in its own length is computed in the cell M7. 68. We do it for all road marks. We do the computations. But as it was said, the most important is the M1 point. It is here where the battle will be decided. The main task is to hit the target by the first shell. We need to take into account the wind. As it was already computed, the side wind component for the axis direction is 4.5 meters per second. The table values are given for the 10 meters per second wind. Therefore, we can take half the table values. The wind is from the left to the direction of fire. Therefore, we need to set crosshair to the left of the target for the given amount in mils to compensate for this. The table value for the distance 1300 meters and side wind of 10 meters per second is 3 mils. We have 1337 meters distance and even less when tanks move closer, and 4.5 meters per second side wind. Therefore, we have to take half the amount of the table adjustment. It is 1.5 mils, but to use fractured mils is impractical and absolutely unnecessary. So we assume the adjustment of 1 mil. The target moves closer, therefore the adjustment value would decrease. The adjustment is to the left, so we write it with minus sign. Here we have the distance of approximately 1 km, proceeding from the very essence of the mil of being an angular value equal to the 1000th part of the distance. We can use this property for better aiming. When you are looking in the optic sight on the vehicle, it is easier to make sight adjustments by employing this conversion of angular values into linear ones. You can easily shift the crosshair from the center of the tank for 1.3 meter to the left, assuming the width of the tank being 3 meters. You aim at the left caterpillar cover and the shell goes at the tank's center. But in general, you need to adhere to the angular adjustments as they are without mental shift from angular to linear values. All optical sights have a reticle graduated in mils, therefore you can easily employ this optical scale for rapid adjustment. The lengthwise wind component is not taken into account for these short distances. When this main task of annihilating the enemy armored core was achieved, we can proceed to mesotically destroy all other vehicles. For this we need to use fragmentation shells and charge 4. Charge 4 with the initial speed of the shell 276 meters per second. And when firing anti-tank shell, it has 680 meters per second speed. These are usual spinning shells, and the drift should be taken into account. In the usual way, we write down all relevant table data and interpolate it for our distances and weather conditions. The target is M1, distance 1337 meters. First, let's compute the interpolation factor, cell K781. The quadrant setting is in the cell B782. The drift is 2 mils, adjustment to the left, minus sign. Any computations are needed because the marginal values are the same. In the cell D782, the computation of the side wind adjustment in mils. The length wind adjustment is computed in cell E782. The pressure is taken into account in cell F782. A temperature influence is computed in cell G782. Charge temperature in cell H782. The flight time is interpolated in cell I782. In the cell J782, we add up all lengthwise adjustment values, and in cell J784, we find the corrected distance. Here it should be again repeated the fact that by the term corrected distance, we should understand the fictitious value which we use to set the quadrant. The real distance was already computed by precise survey methods and doesn't change. We simply use this imaginary distance value for simplifying the process of adjustment. It could be reformulated differently in the following way. The corrected distance is the distance which we would use when all weather factors were normal. Because these factors deviate from those normal table values, we need to reduce the quadrant setting for those values. So we find this fictitious corrected distance value. You need to employ some imagination to absorb this. In cell K783, we compute the new interpolation factor, and in B784, the new quadrant setting is found. In cell C786, we round the quadrant setting, and in cell E782, 86, the rounded sight adjustment is computed. These are the final firing data values for M1 point for fragmentation shell fired with charge 4. In the same way, we find settings for other points, and you can see them against M2, against M3, M4 and M5.
Allahu Akbar! Allahu Akbar!